Blessed be God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Continue to call it prayer. Almighty God, to you our hearts are open, our desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. David and all the people with him set out and went from Baal in Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who is enthroned on the cherubim. They carried the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the Ark of God. And Ahio went in front of the Ark. David and all the house of Israel were dancing before the Lord with all their might, with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. So David went and brought up the Ark of God from the house of Abinadab to the city of David with rejoicing. And when those who bore the Ark of the Lord had drawn 6 paces, he sacrificed an ox and a fatling. David danced before the Lord with all his might. David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. As the Ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David weeping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. They brought in the Ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside. offering burnt offerings and offerings of well-being, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts and distributed food among all the people, the whole multitude of Israel, both men and women, to each a cake of bread, a portion of meat, and a cake of raisins. Then all the people went back to their homes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He distinguished us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed us on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches and his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as we plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to praise of his glory. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
rise before you like incense, and they come back down to bless and heal the world. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, the grace, the mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and all God's people say, Amen. I wanted to talk with you folks for a few minutes this morning about two different meals, two different feasts, two different banquets. So since the last time I preached here, maybe close to 2 years ago, I retired from the Army, hence the beard. I was the chief of the training development division over at the U.S. Army Chaplain Center School, and we retired to North Augusta to be near our grandson. Then I served a residency as a chaplain at the VA in Augusta, currently serving a new calling as a hospice chaplain. A ministry I now feel like God was preparing for all those years without my even knowing it. And one of the beauties of being from a sacramental or a word and sacrament tradition, because most chaplains aren't, is being able to baptize, to perform last rites, and to offer the Eucharist with our patients and families, many of whom have had no in-person pastoral or spiritual care throughout the pandemic. But now, thanks to the gift of vaccines, a way God gives us to help care for God's creation, ourselves, and our neighbors, I now can go into the homes of patients and provide in-person, incarnational pastoral care. I can hold the hands of dying patients and put skin on God's love. So a couple weeks ago, I was out in the Georgia countryside visiting a patient in her 80s dying of cancer. She's from a Pentecostal holiness background. She told me she likes the fact that I wear my collar because it lets people know whose side I'm on. And I said, sometimes it'll get you out of a speeding ticket, too. But don't try. So one day recently, I was visiting, and knowing her time is short as she journeys home to be with God, I asked her if she would like communion. And she instantly started sobbing. She shared that her church, in her words, has forgotten me. My church has forgotten me. She knew they couldn't come visit, but in a year and a half, could you make a phone call? So after we shared the Eucharist, I held her hand, I looked her in the eye, and I said, God has not forgotten you. The folks at a Finnish hospice will not forget you, and I will not forget you. We just shared communion together. The kingdom of God is within you. This is the body and blood of Jesus. This is the full presence of Jesus, who is in this space, in this place, with us and for us. I shared with her, this is a snapshot of the heavenly feast to come, when we will all be home with God and all God's people, gathered around God's banquet table, enjoying the feast of heaven, the banquet table of God, where all are valued and wanted, where God has a place for you, where the God who knows you and created you, where that God never forgets you. Incense is the enemy. But I love it. I love the incense. I share it, it takes me back to my acolyte days at Grace Episcopal Church in Bath, Maine, in the late 60s and early 70s. So anyway, our scripture story today is the story of the beginning of John the Baptist, which is probably why your priest took today off. You wouldn't have to preach on this. And this story seems randomly stuck in between other stories in Mark's Gospel. And I really did not want to preach on this text. I wanted to preach on a different text, but the Holy Spirit led me this way. And I probably wouldn't blame you if you tuned this out this morning. There is enough bad news in the world. This is a horrible story. Jesus doesn't even appear in the story. The story which follows is more encouraging. And that's the story of Jesus feeding 5,000 hungry people and their families. So it's a strange placement of stories. Herod's evil banquet with the mean girl smacks up against Jesus, making sure everyone gets a meal and nobody's head gets chopped off. But these are not side by side randomly. Mark has a point to make. Even though we don't hear the story of the feeding of the 5,000 today, it's a story found in all four Gospels. So we have a story of contrast. Jesus draws to be alone, but a great crowd follows him. It's a deserted place, but it becomes a place of filling and feeding. The disciples say, send them away, but Jesus says, you give them something to eat. The disciples say, we only have 5 loaves and 2 fish, but they end up with 12 baskets left over after 5,000 families eat. So we have deserted fields, send them away, feed them too little, more than enough, and the story of death and the story of life. So many contrasts. But the greatest contrast is between Jesus' banquet of life and Herod's banquet of death. Those stories, which I encourage you to read this week, are side by side for a reason. Mark wants us to see the stark contrast between two very different banquets. Mark is being intentional, even political, even subversive in his fast-paced gospel and storytelling. Herod holds his feast in a lavish setting. Picture a maga banquet, a Bible version of a maga gathering at Mar-a-Lago. Herod's wife Herodias is there, even though she shouldn't have been. Herod stole her from his brother. John the Baptizer condemns the marriage and ends up in jail. Herod, like John the Baptizer, is also Jewish. But like Christians who replace the gospel of Jesus by worshiping at the altar of Donald Trump and his evil empire, for Herod the Roman Empire and the seat at the table of power, even to the point of betraying his own people, had replaced God for him. And that is why, at the end, he dehumanizes John and has him beheaded. Because when you dehumanize somebody, anything goes. When you dehumanize somebody, anything goes. So that is why John the Baptizer dies a political death. When extreme religion and extreme power, when Herod and Caesar crawl into bed together, Caesar will hog the covers and religion will be left exposed. But until he beheads John, Herod is intrigued by John. There is something of the God he remembers from his past. But Herod wants to be liked, and he has a conflict of interest. Does he keep John happy or keep his wife happy? Herod had given his word to the stepdaughter that he would give her anything she wants. Now, I don't think he imagined she would ask for the head of John the Baptizer. Herod doesn't want to do this, but he's painting himself into a corner. His guests have heard his oath, and if he doesn't keep his word, he's going to be in trouble with the higher authorities. So Herod gives the command. John is beheaded. It's a gruesome scene with the head being passed around. And I'm not to freak anybody out, but I've been in Iraq to a beheading factory. It's a scene you don't forget. John's head is brought out on a platter like it's dessert and then passed around. This is a banquet of evil and brutality. This is not a banquet of plenty. This is not a banquet of the ways of Jesus and the Jesus movement. This is not a banquet and a feast of remembrance and grace and invitation and love. There are no cold baskets left over, but John the Baptizer's head on a platter. So you see, Herod could have made a different choice. But empire, power, brutality, and ugliness have replaced God in his life. He liked listening to John, but he couldn't risk his reputation to do the right thing. Much like we've seen in the past 6 months with people who won't admit that our country suffered sedition and an insurrection, and that it was traitors, un-American. Or that people are dead because of one man's ego. Or that the response to a free and fair election is voter suppression. Or that people refuse to be vaccinated, placing themselves and others at risk for insane political reasons. The empire shaped the values and decisions of Herod, not the ways of God, as it seems to do for so many people in our country at this time. It is impossible to worship the ways of empire, which are idolatry, and then also follow the ways of Jesus. When you try to serve two masters, you will only hate the one and love the other, or you will leave behind the one you hate. And I know that tension. I spent my entire Army career as a chaplain living in that tension. And I ended up retiring when I got passed over for promotion to full colonel for defending and advocating for people like your former organist, Brian, and his partner, Cody. The leftovers of empire have always been and are the ways of destruction and death, even when motivated by good and honorable intentions. You watch what happens when we leave Afghanistan after being there for 20 years. The ways of terror, the ways of evil, extreme religion, infused with extreme power, will prevail. Will prevail. Our world is fallen and broken. It is easy to look around and wonder whether Herod has won or is winning. People will follow blindly and believe what they want to believe, even when it's the Antichrist, even when it makes no sense at all, and even when it is unholy, even when it harms their own soul and harms their neighbor. We see it in this text. We witnessed it firsthand and lived it for the past 5 years. So into our fallen and broken world comes Jesus with an alternative vision, the way of Jesus movement. Jesus says, "The kingdom of God has come near you, a banquet is prepared." Over and over and over, Jesus emphasizes the kingdom of God being present now, and then on that great getting up morning when Jesus returns to redeem and make right and make whole. That day when Herod is sent captive. When the kingdom of God is present, when the Jesus movement responds, we are needed more than ever. We hear Jesus say, "They need not go away. You, church, give them something to eat." And what an opportunity we have as we emerge from this pandemic to be church and not to slip back into the old habits and patterns of reducing kingdom work to insider language, busyness, or committee meetings. The church deployed, the extroverted church, the welcoming church, the servant church, the church forced to be the church during the pandemic is needed in a spiritually hungry and hurting world looking for theology and a way of following Jesus which doesn't look like worshiping at the altar of a tyrant and a Herod, but one in which all, and all means all, where all are loved and valued and wanted and welcomed and fully included at the banquet table of life. So, church, I encourage you to take some time this week and read these two stories in Mark. Chapter 6. Then in response, ask yourself what you can do to live out and follow the call of Jesus. What you can do as part of the Jesus movement to give others something to eat at the table of and the banquet of life. So I'll get ready to close by sharing with you. I used to tell our now grown children the same thing I would tell young soldiers. The sum of your life when you're my age is the choices you start making now. Our lives are filled with choices. We all have to serve somebody. Herod chose loyalty to the empire. Millions of our fellow Americans chose loyalty to a modern Herod, even over the ways of Jesus and the Constitution, which I spent my entire adult life protecting and defending. Herod chose to preside over the banquet of death. Jesus calls those who follow him to make a choice in response to grace upon grace upon so much grace. Jesus says, "You give them something to eat." Those first followers, those first disciples, the early Jesus movement could have said, "No, we only have 5 loaves and 2 fish, just enough to feed ourselves." But Jesus calls them. He calls the church. He calls us. He calls you to do something beyond ourselves and beyond yourself. They all had something. You have something, and so do I. Jesus takes what we bring, and like the little drummer boy, he blesses it and multiplies it with love. He takes what we have, and he blesses it. When that happens, there is and there will be a banquet of life for all, now and for all eternity. Amen?
Amen.
This power has been perfect. God of light, you have showered us with blessing. Open our hearts and our hands to those who are hungry, those in our neighborhood, those outside the walls of the church building. Give us the courage to tell the heirs of this world, repent or get behind me, Satan. Give us compassion. Make us full of compassion to those who are hurting and hungry in any way that might be fed. Shape us to be, make us people of life, and all we say and do, in the name of Jesus. Brothers and sisters in Christ, would you join with me in the words of the Nicene Creed? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty,
Maker of heaven and earth,
and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made.
Church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, especially Brian, our postulant, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation, especially Charles,
Damian, Eddie, Virginia, Rachel, Levi, Carmen, Mildred, Cherish, Reginald, Charles, Geneva, Peyton, Gloria, Herman, Gwendolyn, Calvin. Are there others? Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us confess our sins against God and neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you,
in thought,
word, and deed,
by
what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy on us and forgive us,
that we may be united to your will and walk in your ways with the glory of your name.
Amen.
Sinners in Christ, may Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Church, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace of Christ.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Ooh, that's nice. I will not sit here and read all the announcements. I just want to highlight a couple of things. One, while we do what we do, still on pause while Father Raphael was out, it will resume on the 21st. That's both sessions, the 12 and the 6 o'clock session. Next Sunday, we're having our meet and greet for our choristers, and we'd love everyone to join us to meet in the after service. We know them, we hear them, but we may not all know them. So it will give you that opportunity to meet them and have those lovely conversations. Thank you. Father Glenn, you've been wonderful. I remember when you were here before, you were clean shaven, I didn't even retire. But we thank you for your kindness and coming here to share your loving words with us. Have a wonderful Sunday.
What do we get? thanks to our sister here every breath, every day, every birthday. May she take the life and the breath and the goodness you have given her and reflect on all she says and all she does. Give her a blessed and glorious and wonderful birthday. In Jesus' name, and in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother and sister, and then come and offer your gift. Thank you. prophets and sages to reveal your righteous law. And in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill the law, to open for us a way of freedom and peace.
By his blood, he reconciled us, by his wounds, we are healed.
And therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly doors, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim to them your glory and their unending gift. Supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, drink this. them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
siblings in Christ, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with favor.